I'm really not a printmaker, so I enjoy all the adjusting and changing them after they've been printed. And in places, I can lighten the black by putting white pencil over it. This right here is the effect that the printing press gives that the pencil does not do. So by the time I've finished, I can no longer call it a monoprint because I've worked over it so much with all these hand additions. I know it looks like a painstaking job, but I don't mind doing it. Okay, I'm expanding the green area here because even though the sun set was turning a lot of things pinkish and red, the water was still green in this area, and I just like the two colors together. Even though 5 minutes later, they may have been all red. And when I look at what I have here, I see some of the rigging is from the fishing fleet in Portland, and some of the other sailboats off Booth Bay Harbor, so I'm getting a little of everything into this picture. The stencils I draw and start with are done from five or six different working waterfronts in Maine. The earliest of the series were all from Friendship Harbor. The ramp coming down there, and a little bit of rope piled up on the traps there. And I need some little stencils like that, details of things that are on these wharves. This is Sam Cady, a good friend of mine here. Lives in Friendship. He's painted and worked here many, many years. His work has kind of inspired me, even though it's nothing like his work. But we both enjoy the same subject matter and atmosphere. So.
Friendship has made a real point of keeping it a working waterfront. You know, you don't see many services for cruising boats, and you don't see any fancy shops or anything around here because this is a working waterfront, which is fairly rare these days.
It's kind of unique, I would say, now.
Yeah.
This is the richest one in subject matter, though.
Yeah.
Just look at out here.
Wow. You know, the fog is burning off, and you can see Long Island. This is a real kind of typical John Wissemann scene here with so much detail, and you know, the sheds, the docks, the pilings, the buildings going up the hill, a lot of linear stuff, a lot of perspective.
A lot of silhouettes.
Yeah, and it's just about ideal for what John's doing right now because it's a real mixture of abstraction and representation, and very typical of the classic Maine and yet very abstract and modern at the same time.
There's about 10 or 20 compositions right there.
Yeah.
And I like the little things you see between the buildings, like way down there. And look back here.
Yeah.
This is it, my favorite working spot. All the shapes and colors I want to use are right here. Whether I use them sort of realistically or abstractly, they're just all here and they're constantly changing. They keep fascinating me. I thought I had finished with this harbor a few years ago, but coming back today, I can see I've got to come back several more times. I often start with small pencil sketches of the actual buildings on site. And then if I want them bigger, I take them to a printer and have them enlarge my stencil or my drawing for the stencil. Sometimes I get two or three different sizes printed. And if I have them print them on a good paper, I'm all set to start printing them. This is the part where one can be very creative with the stencils once one creates. In fact, several people say they're really more interested in my stencils than in what I use them for. I actually enjoy, it's almost a form of meditation, sitting here and just cutting.
Do you remember when you first started working with stencils?
I think it may have been doing wildflowers here in Cushing. There's a big field right near us. And I was doing some watercolors of flowers. Then I started cutting some out of paper just to see how they'd look. And I started laying them down on my wet watercolors to see what would happen. And they made a strange kind of monoprint of watercolor. I think that was the beginning of it. I like the stencils because they're so mobile. You can use them backwards and forwards, even upside down, and move them from one composition to the next. And I've always liked using stencils. In fact, I used to stencil designs on my own shirts with fabric paint. This is a plexiglass plate. I just ink it completely with black or whatever I want to use. And then I pick up my stencils, and these were just used 2 days ago, so they're still very wet with lithographing. I start making a composition like this. In the composition, I can move them around, get the effect I want, to see which works best for the composition. And there are bits of water coming in and out there, which I like to show. And I would lay, these would be white, no ink on them. I would run them through the press, and I'd come out with a black background, and all these images would be pure white. Then I could reverse the whole thing, since now these have ink on them. I could turn them over and print them again. So they would be like gray or black image on a white paper. That's just the white paper stencil just pressed into the white paper with the printing press. I can see it here, but I especially can feel it. And then we have one here to look at to show you what. This is a trial run, just to see how the stencils work. As you can see, I'm just really fooling around with it to see what happens. And this whole thing, I should have reversed them when I put them down because I wanted the bridge to be over here and the cranes over on this side, but I can easily take care of that next time I print these. And also we'll try some color and things like that. So this is a trial run. I'll probably destroy this one. But at least I can see how the stencils do work, how they look overlapping each other, where I should put more ink or less ink, or leave maybe this piece out completely and just focus on the bridge in the distance.
How long have I known your work? For about 20 years, I think?
I think about 20 years. Yeah. I don't keep track of things like that.
I know that I've been enjoying it for a really long time. And the ones I was first and still enamored of are the ones based on the Japanese prints.
I remember now, that's the first work you ever saw of mine at Round Top.
That's right.
Before that, most of my work had been based on history of art, which I've always fascinated me. And you happened to catch up with me when I had gotten to the 1700s, 1800s Japanese prints. I've just always liked prints, and I thought, you know, I'd like to use them as my subject matter somehow and bring them into the 20th century, and here we are now in the 21st century. But I stuck with that for about 15 years.
The first Japanese prints I remember seeing, you were working in watercolor. Then you worked into the watercolor with colored pencil, and then you started to use the color pencil exclusively. What made you make that move?
I think one year we were traveling, going away the winter for a couple of months, and it was so much easier to take just a set of colored pencils and a nice pad of paper. And I found I liked the colored pencils. And for some reason, when I worked with colored pencils, the whole composition was more colorful than when I was doing the watercolor. I don't know why that happened, but it just did. And I've stuck to them ever since. As the compositions got more and more complicated, it was easier with the colored pencil to keep things under control.
Since I've had the privilege of showing your work for a long time, the earliest ones done in all-colored pencil, I think when you looked at them carefully, you could see that's how they're done. Although people would say, isn't it amazing anyone can do that with colored pencil? And you seem to have, at one point, I don't know, maybe about 8 years ago, moved to a different level. And people look at them now and said, colored pencil, you've got to be kidding.
Well, that's just because I use a lot of pressure. Colored pencils now are made better. They're better quality than they used to be 20 or 30 years ago. But if you press pretty hard, you get good, rich color. And I also put one color right on top of another color. And it does take a long time, but I don't mind that. But I'm thinking back now, one reason I switched to pencil, if I did watercolor and had a paper stencil, it would often ruin the stencil.
Oh, I see.
If I keep them dry with a pencil, they would last longer. And now, I'm largely using lithograph ink on my stencils, and those stencils will last forever. When that ink dries, they become pretty permanent.
Mm. We're almost turning them into a plastic, almost.
Yeah, that's what it's like.
I've always been really intrigued by your color sense, John. What relation do the colors have to the shapes that you're using in the stencils? Is it intuitive? Is it...
At first, they don't have much of a relationship. But if I start out inking with a color and add a second color and print it, then a lot of possibilities arise where one color maybe goes on top of another color, and I see the possibilities of a third color and other combinations. Then I really get to working on it.
Color itself is just very instinctual. And one of the interesting things, actually this might be a good question, is even using the same design, if you change the color scheme, people frequently won't recognize that it's the same design at all.
Oh, that's correct, because I use the same stencils over and over with a different color feeling. You've said it just right. I'm constantly changing my mind when I'm working. You know, things happen and you get other ideas about it, and so you go with it and see what happens.
Well, one of the things I've enjoyed about your work is that I've always admired, particularly you manage that combination of technical precision and a kind of spiritual openness and wit, which I think sometimes technical precision and wit don't always go closely together.
I'm trying to think how I can get a little bit of that wit into these things I'm doing now. Some of them are getting to look a little too serious. I need maybe some shipwrecks in them or things like that going on.
You keep that feeling of improvisation in it.
Yeah, I do want to keep that. Yeah, it's strange because I really love big sort of abstract expressionist kind of painting, which is nothing like what I do, but I like to see that in other people's work.
I'm surprised I don't know this, but could you tell me a little bit about your early training and background?
Well, when Nancy and I first got married and got talking, we discovered that we both, even in grade school, would get through our homework very quickly so we could spend the evening drawing.
Now, this is Nancy Wissemann Reddick, my wife, who's also a painter.
And I taught him everything.
In New York State, when they first mandated art teaching, the first art teacher I had came from Alma, Maine, and she had just graduated from Pratt Institute. She really encouraged me, and that was sort of my inspiration. So after high school, I went in the U.S. Navy for ages 17 to 21. After that, I went to Syracuse University College of Fine Arts. And that's where it all began. And then when Nancy and I started spending summers here in Maine back in the 60s or late 50s, this friend who was my art teacher from Alma, Maine, by that time was retired and living back in Alma, and she came to every show in Maine that Nancy or I had. It was very, wow. We kept in touch with her all those years. So I credit her with a lot.
John, when you were starting, I guess, your professional career, once you were in art school or just out of art school, What sort of work did you start out by making? I was just curious how it developed.
Well, I'd say it probably started mostly in art school with all these interesting professors. And I got introduced to a lot of kinds of art, contemporary and art history, things I had never seen before. So that was pretty new to me. And I think when I first got out of college, I probably was doing more abstract work.
Mm-hmm.
Because that, what I found so exciting right then. I think it was the time of the early abstract expressionists. I didn't stick with that very long till I got into really seeing what I could do with using art history as my subject matter. Before the Japanese figures, I did a whole series based on figures I took out of Renaissance paintings and created my own compositions. I did the same thing with medieval figures, knights in armor in that period. And then I also did a series of Victorian ladies and gentlemen, the figures. I would take them actually from fashion magazines of that time and create my own compositions with them. Then I went way back to ancient Greece, and I was taking figures off the Greek vases and making compositions of those figures based on Greek myths. A large part of my art career has been based upon art history as my subject matter. I still have some ideas of things I would like to do, but I got stuck a long time with the Japanese because I really like Japanese prints, and I always sort of looked at them with a contemporary eye. I thought those 17th, 18th century Japanese prints somehow looked quite contemporary to me, especially compared to, say, Korean art or Chinese art, which always looked very ancient to me. The Japanese printmakers, I think because of their stylization, to me looked very 20th century. So I just wanted to see what I can do with it.
Well, it seems to me that a lot of the patterning and particularly the, shall I say, takeoffs of the patternings that you do as your inventions have as much to do with contemporary American abstraction.
And a few people have written about it, have pointed that out.
John, did you start out by showing in New York City?
I guess you could say I did. There was a little art association out where we live, but it didn't ever aspire to be very much. So Nancy and I both realized we should try to show in New York City, even though we lived 100 miles away. So my very first show in New York City was on Upper Madison Avenue in a gallery. And the reason for that, there was an empty parking space in front of the gallery on Madison Avenue back in those days. So I just went in the gallery that was right there, and they liked the work and gave me several shows.
That's what? I started. Called Serendipity. And what was the name of that gallery, John?
Bodley Gallery. Uh-huh. It's gone now.
Now, what brought you originally to this beautiful spot here?
We were just fortunate. My wife spent time in college with Helen Langley, who was the wife of Bernard Langley, the sculptor here in Cushing. And through, we all got married about the same time, and we would visit them up here in Maine and liked it. Our kids liked it when they were very young, so we decided to come up here for summers. And there were several artists, many from the Skowhegan School, who were in New York at that time. I guess that was the 50s, you know. But we've all remained friends ever since, and most of them are good settled in Maine. We both like the subject matter that's available here in Maine. It sustains us.
Well, I think it's the subject matter that's sustained and inspired
a lot of artists,
and there's really quite a circle of you really in this area. I mean, from Cushing up to Belfast and up around there. Yeah. Did you all arrive at more or less the same time? Or?
Yeah. I guess the Skowhegan School introduced many of them to Maine. But in Maine, one could afford to buy a house and a barn or a place like this way back then.
Do you find that the subject matter that you're have been working on for a while actually leads you to a certain point where something new suggests itself?
I'd say, since I got involved in this bridge at Bath and, say, the Queenspore Bridge, now I'm looking at lots of bridges wherever I go. I look at the structures, gotten interested in structure and cutting silhouettes from structures, you know.
Well, I noticed as you worked on the Working Waterfront, it started out with some of the usual lobster boats and docks and buildings on the docks. And as you worked into it, should we say a little bit more of the mechanics of the Working Waterfront, the pulleys and ropes and gears, and that sort of move more into the industrial part, like that iron work.
That's exactly right, yeah. And then I think it was 2 years ago, was down at my son's house in Falmouth. And I think it was early November, and there was a big snowstorm. And I thought, wow, this would be a good day to go down to the Portland fishing fleet. And I did. And see all that rigging and stuff in the white snow gave me lots of ideas. So some of my recent pictures are just full of all these rigging and ropes. And that started with the Portland fishing.
Well, that could almost bring you to the bridges and other places like the skyline of Manhattan.
Yeah, yeah. I'm thinking of getting down on the Brooklyn Bridge this fall and walking across there.
Oh, there's a classic subject for you. John, you've had a very long career. Do you find there's some threads of continuity that run through your work from the time you were a young man or even a kid?
Well, I recently looked at some old watercolors I had done from 40, 50, probably even 60 years ago. And I was surprised at the relationship between that and what I'm doing now. So I've had this interest in the working waterfront for many years. The town I lived in was farming and fishing, and there was a small fishing fleet there. So that I looked at some of the old paintings, and I could see something in common with these recent ones.
I think you have probably most of your life gone regularly to draw from the figure. Why don't they get into your finished pieces?
Boy, I really don't know. When I was doing the history of art as my subject matter, that was almost all figures. Mm-hmm. So I have to think about that. And someone down at the print center said, too, they notice I don't do figures. It may be because the compositions are getting so complicated that a figure would get lost in them. I haven't figured out yet how to incorporate the figure into the kind of compositions I'm doing right now. But I think I'll try it.
Well, a figure, because tends to grab your interest as a human interest in a way that can almost unbalance a composition if you're, say, emphasizing the formal elements in it.
Yeah. Yeah. Now that I think back, I have used a few figure drawings. I did a series of watercolors based upon Greek and Roman myths. Mm-hmm. And in so many of those myths, the gods and goddesses were nude figures. Mm-hmm. So I did use some of my figure drawings in those.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
So they were not all borrowed from Greek vases?
Or... No, I did use an actual model. Mm-hmm. So I did use a few. Yeah. I did some in the quarry with bathers. But all those ancient myths were great stories and full of figures.
It's interesting because the Working Waterfront series almost suggests that it should have some of the workers themselves, not just their paraphernalia.
That does make sense. I think what happened, I found all the shapes and lines and structures in the subject matter was plenty for me without figures. There was plenty to work with there. When you really look at those trawlers and the shapes on them, I mean, these big things they roll the nets up on and all the rigging. There's just so much subject matter. You wouldn't even see the figure if I put it in there. I still draw from a live model once a week. We have a small group here that gets together once a week. Very seldom have I used any of those figure drawings in my work. Hmm. I just enjoy drawing them and that keep just filing them away. Mm-hmm. So they may work their way into a print sometime. But the working figures at the waterfront, I found the only way I can do them is to quick snap a picture of them and not sit there and draw. Mm-hmm. And then I've tried a few, make a very simple stencil from looking at that photograph.
I see.
Yeah. There are a couple of them have worked into the Queensboro Bridge figures. Very small so far, but we'll see what happens.
The last few years you've been using a printing press as one of your tools. You want to tell me a little about that?
Well, that happened 5 or 6 years ago. Francis Hudson, who runs the Round Top Print Center, invited some artists to come down there and work just to see if we liked it or not. And the only deal was we had to leave one print with them for some benefit auction. And I got to like it. I liked putting things through that press and then being surprised when you lifted the paper and see what you had. So I pretty much have stuck with that. It's also a nice, quick way to cover a big sheet of white paper. And then I don't leave them as prints. I work on them after they dry with colored pencils.
Yeah, well, I think they're formally called monoprints with hand additions. Although you said to me once that it's really a way of painting and drawing, but using a printing press as one of the tools.
Yeah, I don't really consider myself a printmaker. But I do like a certain quality you get that the printing press does on the paper. There's a certain quality that's different from painting or the colored pencil. It's an inkiness that I like. So I've kind of learned how to control it now. Took a while. And that's what I'm doing right now. I spend a lot of time cutting stencils to put on the press. The Japanese figures I was working with, I really finished that whole series before I got into the printing press. So mm-hmm. my subject matter now has changed.
And I understand you're working on a new series about the Manhattan skyline?
Yeah, I got the idea last summer. I was down drawing the old Bath Railway Bridge, which I still like. It's like a, to me, it's like a big piece of modern sculpture stuck in the river there. So this spring, I went out on the Queensborough Bridge with a photographer friend and saw the same kind of structure in a way. But all around it were these cranes working on big high-rise condominiums. They reminded me of the cranes at Bath Iron Works. So right now I'm working in the series of the Bath Iron Works and Manhattan right around the Queensborough Bridge. They have a lot in common.
I noticed that as you developed your stencil theories of the working waterfront here in Maine, that some of the earlier ones were fairly straightforward impressions, and actually people very often think that they're a woodcut. But as you developed it, you started to do quite a bit of overprinting, or am I mistaken?
That's right. Printing the same print again and again and using different stencils on top of the earlier stencils. So it does have a different effect. I started first with this little harbor right here at Cushing, and then I went on to Friendship. And then I started doing drawings at Portland, Belfast, Rockland. So I now have a whole series of stencils, and I'm starting to combine them all. There's a new one right there. And that one is the New Bath Bridge.
May I touch it, John?
Yeah. I haven't printed that yet. I'll probably do it tomorrow.
It's in two parts.
Hold the white side up. It'll show better.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
Yeah. See, that's okay. From the back of a photograph. Right. And I just eliminated most of the photograph. So we'll see how it prints tomorrow.
Fascinating.
Well, I do like cutting stencils or creating them. I spend a lot of time on that. After about 3 hours, this gets pretty exhausting.
John, how did you arrive at or discover this particular process and know it was a good creative move for you?
Well, several years ago, Francis Hudson, who runs the Midcoast Printmakers, invited me to the Round Top print room because she knew I had been working with stencils. And she saw there would be possibilities with the printing press and the stencils. That's how I started, and I discovered I liked it.
I'm really sort of composing with color now. And I'll be putting the stencils on top of this. Just blending it in. And I'm leaving sort of vertical and horizontal streaks because it'll fit in with the subject matter. This will be city buildings. Okay, I think we're ready to start putting some stencils down.
I think next to actually inking the plate with stencils on it, the next most important part is arranging those stencils. I'm really trying to make an interesting composition. So I keep moving them around. When I think I've got sort of what I want, I'll print it. And then I can run it through the press a second time with another stencil on top to make the composition more interesting to myself.
I'm overlapping stencils there.
I had to have quite a few because the lithograph ink takes so long to dry. Things I printed last Monday, I can't use those stencils tomorrow because they're still sticking. Oh. I may use them a week from tomorrow. So I had to have 60 or 70 stencils to work with.
Wow, that's a lot.
Yeah.
That's a lot of
well,
cutting.
Well, I use 5 or 6 or 7 in a composition.
Mm-hmm.
And then I put them aside, take 6 or 7 more, and that ends up finally. If you want to do, say, 5 prints of a morning, you've used 35, 40 stencils right then.
All right, I'll run this through once and see what it all looks like. These are all the Queensboro Bridge with parts of Manhattan in the background. And it's just going to be the first run through. So I just want to make sure I have it all on there. Go a little further this way, let's see.
John, using the printing press must allow you to do many more variations much more rapidly than your old do-it-all-by-hand method.
Oh, it's much quicker. I think that's what I really liked about it. You can sort of get a composition in a few minutes and then rapidly change it.
How many prints are you able to pull in a 3-hour session?
I try to do 3 or 4.
I see.
Maybe, including a ghost print, 5 or 6.
That's great for printing right on top of. I'm just lifting this off, but it leaves an imprint on the plate.
Explain to me what a ghost print is.
A ghost print is when you print your paper and take it off, there's a lot of ink left on this plexiglass plate. If it looks like enough ink left, I'll run another paper through and get the same print, but instead of black, it'll be grays. But I'd say my most interesting prints come out of ghost prints.
This will look very different from the first run through there.
Okay. Let's see what we got. Let's see how different those city buildings came out on the previous one. Let me get that one a look.
John Wissemann is one of the printers who uses our equipment during the open studio here at Midcoast Printmakers. John Wissemann, in working with stencils, I think is very unusual. Stencils have been used in printmaking for a long time. However, I don't know many artists who totally work with stencils as he does. He spends all winter cutting these intricate stencils, and I'm sure they're from sketches that he's done of the locations. But there are not many people working this way, and it's a pleasure to see his results.
And all this is ready for some dark stencils on top. But I like what it looks like, the sunlight, the light is coming through just in the center. But I think we'll put the first one back in and put some stencils on it and see what happens.
Now, do you find that a useful way of working? I mean, obviously it works for you, but to have different parts of the process are really so different as activities. I mean, cutting a stencil is one kind of activity. Printing is a very different. And then the handwork at the end. So they almost, you can operate in, so I say, you almost need a different state of mind.
The printing especially, because you have to go pretty fast. I soak the papers first. You don't want them to dry out. Once you print it, you roll all that ink. You don't want the ink to dry. So I find I'm on my feet, very active for 3 hours steady. Mm-hmm. Hardly time to think.
Is that good?
For me, it is. I think I do most of this composing intuitively. I don't think about it too much. I think when I'm drawing the original stencil and cutting it, but the actual printing of it, I just go by what looks right.
Do you see an element you like in one print and then use it in another?
Yeah, I see something I like. Well, I will try that again with another stencil.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's the interesting part about it.
Yeah.
First, look at that print when it comes out of the press and gives you an idea for the next one.
Mm-hmm.
So some days I come home with 3 or 4 prints weren't all what I expected to do. Dampened paper.
And when these are dry, I'll probably bring them back next week and do a little printing on top of them. Okay, here's a print that will need another going through. I'm going to print a darker black right on there. I'm going to print this stencil right on top of there, slightly off register, so I get a few white lines showing like I have there. It's going to be like that. So I have to ink. Make sure I get the ink on the right side now. Okay, the ink side is going down right there. So okay, that's what we want to get up there.
So, John, you're going to tell me about your next things on your agenda, what you're going to be working on next.
The biggest time I spend is taking these prints out after they dry and studying them and then deciding what I want to do. So I'll spend more time working on them with colored pencils, or sometimes just a black pencil. That'll take more time than actually cutting the stencils and doing the printing. The major time is spent now just creating the composition, getting the color effect I want, or just generally completing it.
So did a lot of it consist on sitting in a chair and staring at it?
Yeah, or working on it. The printing part of it is really the quickest part. It takes the least time, because I've spent a lot of time drawing and then cutting a stencil. And composing on the press is fairly quick. And running it through is quick. And then, right then, I sometimes will run it through a second time with another stencil on it, or even a third time. But then I have to put it away for a while for it to dry. So when I get it out again, look, it'll be kind of a surprise. But I have enough prints begun that it'll take me probably till next spring to finish them. And by that time, I may have some new ideas if I go on the Brooklyn Bridge or something like that.
Wow.
But I still have plenty of subject matter for the Working Waterfront that I haven't finished yet, even from last year, some prints I did.
That haven't, you haven't started
haven't
to
worked
do
on
the
yet.
The
I did
handwork.
So many. Last fall, I did a lot. Yeah. I haven't done as many this fall, but I have to have plenty to work on. So that's what I'll be spending my time on. I'd say by the time I finish with the printing press, the picture is half done. And that second half will take much longer than the first half.